Welcome to EPG Patishala, series of lectures on computer networks. So we will be looking at address management in IP. So what do we mean by address management? Okay, there are two things that we talk about when we talk of address management with respect to IP. One is address resolution and address configuration. Okay, so we will look at protocols which are related to both these, address resolution and address configuration. So ARP, or the address resolution protocol, is something which is used to resolve addresses between, or to map addresses between, the IP address and the MAC layer addresses. So we look at the details of that. And then DHCP is a dynamic host configuration protocol which is used to assign IP addresses to machines. So we will take a look at the details of these two protocols. Okay, so what do we normally mean by the term address resolution? Normally what we mean by address resolution is that you are doing some kind of a translation of addresses at different layers. So we talk about address resolution when we talk about DNS, right? Host name to IP address. DNS is one type of address resolution. Similarly, with respect to IP addresses, there is one more resolution which is very important, which is the IP address to Ethernet address resolution, which is important especially in the IPv4 networks. Okay. So why do we need this? The reason we need that this address resolution is that every node has a physical address which is part of the MAC address, which is hardwired on the on your network interface card. Okay, it is specified on the network interface card. It is fixed to that. It's a unique address. And we assign IP addresses. And the way we assign IP addresses are in a manner that you can identify the network part separately, node part separately, and so on, right? So the IP addresses are basically logical addresses. So you are giving a logical address and it also has a physical address. So we need obviously to do a mapping between the physical address and the logical address, so that given an IP address, you know that this is the physical machine which corresponds to this address. Okay, so that identification has to be done. So that mapping has to be done. So we need this address resolution mechanism. So, so what do we actually do when we map IP addresses into physical addresses? Which are the places that we really need this? So at the destination host, we need to find out which is the destination host, right? When you come to the router, at a router, you may be connected to a destination host, or you may be connected to an extra router. Now I need the IP address of the, I have the IP address of the destination host, but I need the physical address of that host to be able to deliver that packet exactly to that particular host. So I need this address translation mechanism there. Okay. The techniques that are normally used is that one very simple way of doing it would be you kind of encode the physical address as part of the IP address itself. You could do that if your IP address was large enough and your physical address will fit into that. Okay. Unfortunately, in IPv4, that is not possible. There's a possibility of doing it in IPv6, and it is actually done in IPv6. But now we are looking at IPv4. So in IPv4, you can't encode the physical address into the host part of the IP address. Okay, so which means we need some other mechanism. So what we go in for is normally a table-based mechanism, a table lookup, which tells you that okay, for this physical address you have to use this corresponding IP address, or for this IP address you have to use this physical address. So that's the mechanism that we look at, and that is what is done in the ARP protocol, or which is the address resolution protocol. Okay, so this ARP protocol basically has a table of IP to physical address bindings. Okay, and when it requires an address, a binding for an IP address which is not there in the table, it will just broadcast that IP address. So a target machine which has that IP address is supposed to respond to it with the physical address, and now you can make that entry also in your table. Okay, and the stable entries, again, they are not kept forever. You will keep refreshing them periodically and you will discard them if they are not used for some time and so on. So that's basically the ARP protocol, and that's how it works. So we'll take a look at the ARP protocol in a little bit more of a detail. Okay, so as we said, the protocol operates in the following manner. That is, you've got the IP address, you have to find out what's the corresponding the physical address, right? That is, you come to a router. Now the router knows that this IP address is on this particular interface. The routing operation has been done. Now you have to identify the node which matches that particular IP address. So what does the router do? The source node which wants to send this packet, what does it do? It will broadcast an ARP request packet on the IP subnet. Okay, now all the nodes which are there on this subnet will receive this ARP request packet. Now what will this request packet say? This request packet essentially will say, this is the IP address I am looking for. Okay, somebody who has a matching IP address, please reply with your physical address. That's the meaning of this request packet. So when this request packet is broadcast, everybody receives it, but only the target node which has the matching information will be the one which sent back a reply packet, and it will unicast that packet. So now the source node receives the reply, so it gets the MAC address of the target node and uses that to forward the packet, that particular packet. Okay, and it uses a cache where it can keep this information, this table or whatever, it uses an ARP cache. it keeps this information that is just acquired in this cache, so that immediately after that, if another packet needs to be sent to the same address, it again need not go through the ARP process. It can look at the cache and it can take the information from the cache directly. So that's the idea that is used. So if you look at the ARP packet format, you will see that there are a number of fields here. What is interesting about the ARP packet format is that it is kind of a general address resolution protocol format, which means it's not meant only for IP address to MAC or Ethernet layer mapping. It can be used for any hardware type address to any protocol type address mapping. Okay, so which is why we have two fields here, which are called as hardware type field and a protocol type field. This will identify which type of hardware we are looking at, which is the protocol type that you are looking at. Okay, so in this example, we have specified a value of 1 and 800, which corresponds actually to, for instance, the IP Ethernet protocol and the IP protocol. So we want to do a mapping between Ethernet and IP. Okay, so you have a hardware type and protocol type that's specified. Now, depending on the hardware type and protocol type, the length of the field that you have for the hardware address and the protocol address, right, these two may be different. So the protocol address, remember, is your logical address. Hardware address is your physical address. So the length of this address itself could be different. For instance, in IP, your protocol address is 32 bits, whereas Ethernet is 48 bits. So that will have to be specified. Okay, and then you have fields here which specify the source hardware address. So for instance, here there are 6 bytes, so you have 6 bytes for that. And then the source protocol address, 4 bytes for that. Similarly, target hardware address and target protocol address. So these are 4 pieces of information that are really important. And then you also have an operation field which tells you whether this is a request or whether this is a reply. So both ARP requests and ARP replies use the same packet format. The same packet format is used. It's just this operation here will tell you whether it's a request packet or reply packet. And you can see that the information here in a request packet, the source hardware address will be specified and the source protocol address will be specified, whoever is sending it. And the target hardware address will not be specified, the target protocol address only will be specified. In the reply packet, all the information will be specified, right? So this is basically the difference that you will have between a request packet and a reply packet, okay? And so the source, target, physical and protocol addresses are all specified within this particular format. Now, in the ARP cache or the ARP table that is maintained, what will be the kind of information that we have there? You will have this mapping between the IP address and the link level address. So entries can be added or refreshed whenever an ARP requests, when a request arrives at a target node, which means you know that. So let's say I already have an entry for a particular address. Okay, in fact, you need to understand one more bit here. When an ARP request is sent, right, what the target node will do is it will pick up that information which is there in that request. The request will have the source's IP address and the source MAC address. So that information is useful mapping information which can be used by the target, right? So the target will add that information into its cache. Okay. So every time it requires receives a request, an ARP request from some particular source, it can add that information, it can add an entry corresponding to that information into its cache. And normally these entries are removed after a particular time because you don't want to have entries which are there for a very long, which are not used at all for a very long time. For instance, you may not be contacting a particular node at all. So there's no point in having the entry for that node in your cache for a very long time. So periodically, normally a period of about 15 minutes is used. On a timeout of 15 minutes, entries will be removed from the cache. But before that, if there are references to that particular entry, it will keep getting refreshed and keep remaining in the cache. Okay. So this is basically the mechanism that is used in the ARP cache table. Okay, we call it as ARP cache, we also call it as ARP table. So both terms are used interchangeably. Okay. And how is this ARP packet actually sent? Now remember, this ARP packet has to be sent as encapsulated into a MAC frame, right? So the ARP packet will be taken and it will be sent as a packet which is carried by the MAC protocol. So if you are using Ethernet, for instance, a protocol ID is given to that to identify that this corresponds to a MAC frame. Okay, and since it will be broadcast, an ARP request we said is broadcast. So what will be the destination address of an ARP request packet? It will be the broadcast address of all ones. So that's the address that will be used for sending the request packet. So this is basically how the ARP mechanism will work. And remember that the ARP replies are sent as unicast packets, so we don't have a problem with that. So using this very simple request and response mechanism, ARP is used to do this mapping between the IP address and the MAC addresses. Okay, so this is basically what we do. Next, coming to the address configuration part. Okay, so we looked at how the address resolution is done. Now looking at the address configuration part. The point that we are trying to address here is, how does a host get an IP address? How is it configured with an IP address? Okay. So how do I assign IP addresses to a host? You could do it manually, or you could do it automatically, right, using some kind of a dynamic process. Okay. So why would I need this address configuration? I need this because Ethernet addresses, we know, are specified by the manufacturer. They are already hardwired into your network interface card. But IP addresses, you would like to assign IP addresses to your machine depending on what is the network address that you have, and so on, right? So because it has to, the IP addresses have to be unique on a given internet network, but they must also reflect the structure of the network, because we know that the different nodes which belong to the same network, they have to have a common prefix. So if I connect now my machine to a particular network, I know that it has to be given an IP address which matches with the IP address of that particular network. So that needs to be done. So how do we do this, right? So that is something that we have to figure out. Okay. Another reason why we would also like to do this address configuration is that, again, remember, we are always short of addresses. So an organization, for instance, a local organization may have 1,000 nodes, but at a time, not more than 100 people may be using it. So in which case, 100 IP addresses may be sufficient, okay, to be assigned to this particular network, rather than assigning 1,000 addresses. So in these cases, right, if I am able to dynamically assign IP addresses, I can share a given set of IP addresses among more number of nodes. So that's another advantage of doing address configuration. So essentially, it allows me to manage the network in a better manner. Okay. So how do we do manual address configurations? Many of you may be familiar with this. You can actually go into your Windows machine or your Linux machine. Okay, and as if you log in as a system admin, you will find that if you go through control panel, network configuration, TCP IP properties, and so on, you can specify the IP address. Or similarly in Unix, if you go into /etc/rc.config, you could go and specify what the IP address of your machine is going to be. But obviously, any manual configuration is a lot of work. It's a lot of confusion that would lead, especially when your network is large. Two or three machines in my network, you can manage. But when you have thousands of network nodes in your network, it's very difficult to do it manually. Okay, and lots of errors can creep in, and then you will have your entire network going down. Okay, so we don't want that. So we want an automated configuration process. So this automated configuration process is facilitated by a number of protocols. Okay, so there have been an evolution of address configuration protocols, so to say. We started off first with a protocol called reverse RARP protocol, and then we had the BOOTP protocol, and then now we have the dynamic host configuration protocol. So we'll look at DHCP in detail. We'll just touch upon the other two. So in reverse ARP, as you can see, as the name says, right, it is a reverse of ARP. Now, what did we do in ARP? In ARP, we had a IP address, and we were asking for what is the corresponding matching MAC address. Now, in reverse ARP, okay, this is typically used in diskless workstations to discover the IP address. So a machine comes up, right, it does not know what its IP address is, but it knows what its MAC address is, because that MAC address is configured into its hardware interface card, network interface card. So it says, so in reverse ARP, what a node will do is, it will say, this is my MAC address. Can anybody tell me what my network address is? What is my IP address? Okay. So for RARP, we normally have an RARP server on the network, which will keep a mapping of addresses, physical addresses and IP addresses. And when it gets a RARP request saying that, can somebody give me the IP address for this MAC address, the server will respond with that information. And then the node gets its IP address assigned to it. So this is a scheme which is used basically in diskless workstations, not popular anymore. Okay. So then we have had the BOOTP protocol, which basically uses UDP messages. So remember, your ARP, RARP are all happening more at a lower layer. So BOOTP is a protocol which makes use of UDP messages, and there's something called a BOOTP server, which will have this information of mapping between the MAC addresses and the IP addresses, and from there you can get the IP address assigned to you. So we will look at the DHCP protocol, which is actually a much better version, you can say, or it's kind of derived from the BOOTP protocol. So in that sense, we would have also covered the BOOTP protocol to an extent by doing that. Okay, so let's look at this DHCP protocol. So for DHCP protocol to work, okay, so these are the elements that need to be there in the network. Now, in your network, right, so let's say your host is here, okay, it's connected to some network, some subnet, and there has to be some kind of a DHCP server which is connected to your network. Now, this DHCP server may be directly sitting on your network itself, or it may be connected through what's called as a DHCP relay agent, okay, DHCP relay through this to your network. Okay, so I have my host network. So DHCP server can be directly on this network, or I have a relay which is connected here. The relay knows how to reach the DHCP server. Okay, so it may go through other networks as well, but relay knows exactly how to reach the DHCP server. Okay, this is the situation that you have. Okay, right. So now what DHCP will do is, this is responsible for providing all the configuration information that's required for this host. So which means this dynamic host configuration protocol can be used not only to give IP addresses, but also to give other information which is required for a node when it comes up. Okay, so we'll take a look at that briefly. Okay, and normally for a given administrative domain, there is at least one DHCP server. So when I say at least one, it obviously means that you could have more than one DHCP server as well. So if you have more than one DHCP server, so then you could get an assignment from any of those DHCP servers. So we'll look at how you'll choose one of those DHCP servers and so on. So what this DHCP server normally will do is that it will maintain a pool of available addresses, right? So it has a set of addresses, so from which it keeps handing out addresses as it receives requests from hosts for an IP address. The goal of DHCP is basically to dynamically obtain the IP address from the network server when a machine joins the network. And we also need to make sure that it can renew its lease on address in use. That is, normally what is done is it leases an address for a particular duration of time, and even before the time expires, it should be able to renew its lease if necessary, right? That we should allow it. And we should also allow reuse of addresses. That is, you hold the addresses only while you're collected, or while you're connected, or while you're on. That is only when you actually need it. Otherwise, you should be able to release the address, and that address can be reused by somebody else. And we should have support for mobile users when they join the network. So these are some of the goals of DHCP. So how does DHCP actually do this? Let's take a quick overview and then we will look at it in detail. So the first thing that will happen is when a host joins a network, it broadcasts what is called as a DHCP discover message, right? So this is the first step that not normally take place. Now the DHCP server then will respond with an offer saying that this is the IP address that I can offer for you for whatever duration of time, whatever conditions, right? So that's what it specifies. Now, on receiving the offer, the host now will send an IP request for an IP address by means of a DHCP request message. So this is the actual request message, right? And then the DHCP server to which the request has been sent sends back an acknowledgement message. So once the acknowledgement message is received, that particular device has been assigned that particular IP address. So it can start using that IP address. So this is the overall picture. Now let's look at how exactly this will take place. Now this typical situation that we have is that you'll have a host connected to a network. You may have a DHCP server directly on that network, or it may be connected through a DHCP relay. That is, I may have a DHCP relay on the network. This relay in turn is connected to a DHCP server. So now what will happen is, when a host sends this broadcast DHCP discover message, right, it will send it as a broadcast message. So since it is a broadcast message, it uses a special IP address of all ones, right, 255.255.255.255. And it is broadcast on this network. Now this DHCP relay will pick this message and relay it to the DHCP server. It knows the address of the DHCP server. It will unicast it to the DHCP server. Okay. So the DHCP server basically receives a DHCP discover message. When it receives this message, it will send a reply, right? So either it sends a reply directly, if it is on the host, on the network, it sends it directly to the host, or it is the DHCP relay which receives a reply from the server and sends it to the host. Okay, both these are possible. Okay, so now let's look at the state diagram of how this will take place. On the DHCP client side, right, this is what we are normally concerned with. So in an initial state, that is where it is not bound to any IP address, when it needs an IP address, it sends out a DHCP discover message. So on sending a DHCP discover message, it goes into an offer state. So in this state, it is basically waiting for DHCP offers to come. Now remember that you could have more than one DHCP server that is connected to that network. So there can be more than one DHCP offers that could come to a particular device when it sends out the DHCP discover message. So when it receives more than one offer, it can choose one of those offers, right, based on whatever criteria. And depending on which server it has chosen, it sends out a DHCP request to that particular server. So once that is sent, it goes into what's called as a request state. So in the request state, it's basically waiting now for, it has sent a request, it's waiting for an acknowledgement to come. So on receiving a DHCP ACK from the server, now it goes into a bind state. So in the bind state, it has got its IP address, and that particular IP address is now assigned to this. Okay, so it goes into a bind state. It continues to remain in the state as long as for whatever period of time the lease has been given, right? In addition to that, what it normally does is at about some percentage of the entire lease period, say something like about 75% or whatever, it'll send out a renewal request. Okay, it can send out a renewal request, and if it sends a renewal request asking for the same IP address or whatever, it may get back a DHCP ACK. So when it sends the DHCP ACK, right, so then it knows it is it continues to be bound to that same IP address, so it can continue to use that IP address. So when it sends out a request, it goes basically into a state called a renew state. Now at this state, either it gets back a DHCP ACK or it could also get a DHCP NACK. A NACK is a negative acknowledgement. It says that it is not, that the server says it is not able to give that IP address to it. So in which case, it has to go back to the initial state and go back to the whole process of discovering DHCP server and finding and getting a new IP address assigned to it. Okay. So in the, when the rebind expires, okay, it again sends a DHCP request, and again in the rebind state it's waiting for an ACK or a NACK. If it gets an ACK, it gets back to the bind state. Otherwise, it goes to the if it gets a NACK, it goes to the initial state, and the whole process will start again. Okay. So these are some things that we see. This idea of, you know, trying to renew the lease even before the lease expires. These are some additional things which allow for the continuity of the IP address to be used by the client. Okay, this is a basic idea that is used in the DHCP client. Okay, so if you look at the packet format, DHCP packet format, you'll see that there are a number of fields that are there, but the ones that we are normally concerned with are these two, right? That is, what is your IP address and what is the client hardware address? So you specify what your hardware address is, and to that you have to be assigned your IP address. So when a request is sent, the IP address is not specified. When the server sends a response message, in the response message you will find that is, when it gives an ACK, you will find that the IP address is filled by the server and sent. In addition to that, you can see that there are many other fields that are used: server IP address, router IP address, server host name, boot file name, and so on, which basically tells us that in addition to just getting the IP addresses, there are many other parameters also which can be got from the DHCP server. So, and the DHCP packet format supports all those as well. Okay. Okay. So more information, for instance, things like you can have the default router that is to be used, or the subnet mask that is to be used. All these are additional information that could be got. Okay. And this is encoded basically in the option field. You can specify there's a code and a length parameter, so you can specify those things. So for instance, if the ID is 1, it indicates the request parameter is a subnet mask. If it is 3, it's asking for the default gateway. 6, asking for the DNS server, host name, domain name, boot path, NIS domain name, and so on. Okay, so like this, there are many parameters that you could ask for as part of the DHCP message itself. Okay, among the different options that we have that we saw, right, that is, if it is of types 1 to 7 with a code value of 53, that is used for specifying the different types of DHCP messages that we just saw, right, the ones like DHCP discover, offer, request, DHCP decline, ACK, NACK, and release. Okay, these are the different messages that can be sent, that can be exchanged between the DHCP client and the server. Okay, so when a new machine basically joins, we just take a look at an example to understand exactly what is happening. So when a machine arrives, right, so a new DHCP client needs an address in this particular network. So what does it do? So it will, the arriving client sends out a broadcast request saying, is there a DHCP server out there? Okay, now it's a broadcast request. It is sent using the source at IP addresses all zeros. Remember, it does not know what its source IP address is. So if a DHCP packet has to be sent, which is carried in an IP packet, so what is the address that you put in the source address? Since you do not know your address, the special address, which is of all zeros, that is the value that is used in the source IP address. Destination IP address is all ones because you want to broadcast this message. So a source address of all zeros, destination address of all ones, this special IP packet, right, is sent first by the client. And your address, it does not know what its IP address is, so that field is also filled with zero, right, and there is a transaction ID that you are specifying to it, let's say. Okay, so now the DHCP server, which is present there, right, it receives this broadcast and it sends back another broadcast saying, I am a DHCP server and here's an IP address you can use. So this is the information that is given by this. So if you look at the IP packet which is the response from DHCP offer from the server, it will have the source address of the DNS server, right? The destination address is all ones, indicating that it is a broadcast, and it gives an address that this fellow can use, that the arriving client, which is requesting an address, that it can use. So 223.1.2.4 is the address that is given to it. And you can see that there's a transaction ID that is used. The same transaction ID is there both in the discover message and the offer message. So these two, this field can be used to tie this discover message to this offer message, right? So then on receiving the offer, this fellow sends out a DHCP request, which again is broadcast, right? He says, okay, I will take that IP address, right? So the source value is again still all zeros, destination IP address is all ones, and it accepts this address, right? So it says that yes, I will take this address. Now in response to that, the DHCP sends an ACK, which is again broadcast, says, okay, you got that IP address. So now again, you will see the source address is that of the DNS server, destination address is all ones, and your address is confirmed, the IP address that has been given to this client, okay, and the lifetime for which this thing can be used. Okay, so these are the things that you will see, that you can see as the different messages and the way these messages are sent using the IP protocol. Okay, what we can also note is that the DHCP can return more than just that allocated IP address. What are the information that other information can give? It can give the address of the first hop router for that client. It can give name and IP address of the DNS server. It can give a network mask, right, indicating network versus host portion of the address, just as we talked about, right, the subnet mask can be specified, okay. So, just an example to go through the different layers that we are going through. So, remember the DHCP is running on top of UDP, which runs on top of IP. So, your DHCP message basically goes all the way through the various layers, right, goes to the physical layer, it's broadcast at the physical layer, right, and it reaches the DHCP server. So, at the physical layer of the DHCP server, then it is picked up. It is picked up and it goes to the sent to the DHCP server program, which is running at the application layer. Okay, and in response to this, the DHCP server now sends out an offer. So, and that you can see again is broadcast and it is sent goes through the physical layer and goes all the way to the DHCP server, to the DHCP client. So, this process is what you need to be aware of, right? What is very interesting to note over here is that a node which does not know its IP address is able to use the IP protocol itself to get the its IP address using this DHCP protocol. DHCP protocol is running on top of IP, right? So how is this possible? How does this happen? If you see that, it's basically because IP has these special addresses. You have an all ones address which can be used for broadcast and an all zeros address can be used as a special address indicating that this node on this network, you know, that's kind of special address. When you don't know your IP address, you use a value of all zeros, okay, right. So, this is just an example of what a Wireshark output would look like. The Wireshark, if you are familiar with it, is basically some kind of a network analyzer program. So, you can run this Wireshark program and take a look at what kind of information actually takes flows on your network when this DHCP request is sent and a DHCP reply is sent and so on. Okay, you will find that there is so much of information that is exchanged between the client and the server. This is just to give you a snapshot of that. You can run this program and check it out for yourself. Okay. Now, how to get the subnet part? We said that the subnet part of the address can also be obtained, right? So, normally what is done is the network will get some allocated portion of its provided of its provider's ISP's address space. Okay, so if I have, for instance, if an ISP has a block of addresses, okay, let's say it has 200.23.16.0, right? So organization 0 now, for instance, could get a part of that address. So you can see, for instance, there are 8 different organizations that need to share this block of addresses. You can see that the last 3 bits over here, 000, 001, 010, and all the way up to 111. Okay, all these last 3 bits of this network portion of the address is the one that can be used to get the subnet part. Okay, that will indicate the subnet part. Okay, so you can see that the different subnet addresses that we have here, right? So these will be the subnet addresses that are specified along with the mask value, right? So this is, so you have a block of addresses. This block is divided into these different organizations' addresses. Okay, and that's, and this subnet addresses can be specified when you send out the DHCP response, right? So that is when you ask, if a node is to where to ask for a subnet mask, it will get the subnet mask based on which part of the address space has been allocated to it. Okay, so now we've been talking a lot about addressing. So one last word about how does an ISP get its block of addresses? We said that ISP will have a block, and from that block, for my subnet, I can get some addresses assigned from it. But how does the ISP itself get its block of addresses? So that actually is done through the international organization, which is the ICANN, Internet Corporation for Assigned Numbers, Names and Numbers. You have this website called www.icann.org. Now, this organization is responsible for allocating addresses, for managing DNS, for assigning domain names and resolving disputes and so on. Okay, so this completes for us the picture on how IP addressing gets done, starting from how IP addresses are assigned, how it is done using classful addressing, classless addressing, and how these addresses are managed, the protocols that we have for that, and then finally the how these IP addresses are actually managed by some organization. Okay. So to summarize, what we have looked at in this module are basically two things. First, we have looked at the address resolution protocol and ARP and its details, and then we looked at how address configuration is done with the help of DHCP. So we looked at the DHCP messages, the state diagram, and some of the details of this DHCP protocol. Thank you.